everyone. We're about to start our celebration. Delisle, family members, friends, and colleagues, it's a real pleasure to have you join us this afternoon as we celebrate Neville's retirement from the bank. As you would imagine, it's an extremely real pleasure for me. However, as you know, Neville is retiring after 37 years, 4 months, and 6 days at the bank. Yes. And as we celebrate this afternoon, we know that this achievement has been made possible through the father. And I'm going to, in acknowledgement to this, I'm going to invite my brother Mark to say a prayer.
Blessing Neville and celebrating his retirement. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Mark. This afternoon, as I said before, is one of celebration and fun, and we want you to enjoy it to the fullest. We have asked Peter, David Boyce, and Delisle, of course, to speak today on Neville's behalf. We recognize that many of you would like to say something to Neville, and we are inviting you to do so on a one-on-one, no pun intended, of course, rather than in a formal setting. And to get things rolling, I'm going to invite Peter to the podium.
Thank you, Cheryl. Let me retrieve my dossier, which will be very, very short, even though I've known Neville for a long time. And also, given that we're having the speeches before lunch, I guess that is strategic. They have to be short, no. What can I say about Neville? The first thing I can say is that he's a gentleman. As most of you can attest, he's always well attired, well spoken of. Neville can find something good to say about anyone. And even though Neville is very analytically, he can be very tough. He's one of these guys who is deceptively calm, but underneath there's always something going on. Neville is full of energy, and Neville has been involved in so many things, but he always wears this very calm exterior. I actually knew Neville before he came to the bank because his best friend, Royal Branker, not the cricketer, another Royal Branker, was married to my cousin, but he died. But this is many, many years ago, so I knew Neville when I guess I must have been a teenager. I thought Neville was much older because he always appeared to be so mature, so in charge of his life. You know, I've never seen any boyish traits in Neville whatsoever. He was always a gentleman, always a matured individual, always knew what he wanted to do. And so, surprise, surprise, I came to the Central Bank and I found Neville there. He could have been, I don't know how old he was, but early 20s. When I came to the bank and I saw him, I think he had hair. and a beard. In those days, if you didn't have an afro, you weren't anybody, and the girls wouldn't look at you. So I believe he had an afro. Neville is one of these guys who is very adaptable. He could have been anything. in the exchange control area, I always thought that the exchange control department at one time functioned a bit like the immigration department, where people were very, what's the word, astute, very precise. We were able to quote regulations. And when we say no, it is no. And when you raise that hand with the exchange control stamp on it, you know, that's authority coming down, you know. Neville fit in so well in this environment because he's adaptable. He could be a good policeman. He could also be a good sales manager. You know, whatever you want to do, Neville can be it because he's just adaptable. Don't mistake the fact that he is easygoing and calm and so on for you know, don't believe that his talents are limited. This guy is unlimited. He's innovative. He's a deal maker. When I was in the research department, whenever I had a problem that I couldn't handle, Neville was a fix-it man. Neville can charm a snake. whether it be a rattlesnake or a bushmaster. Bushmaster is a snake that eats other snakes. Neville can charm, you know, Neville can get things done. One of my fondest memories was one day Neville and I were trying to complete the annual report. We did this often, we did 7 or 8. This particular year, the printers had no end of trouble. Now, the annual report has to be finished by a certain date. And as we approached the date, the printers kept saying, yes, we coming, man. The document ready. It ready. And the document never came. Until about Friday, about 5 o'clock, the document came. We had like a day left. And then we had to take it to the governor. He had to read it and so on. And we're nervous, but you know, Neville doesn't show that he's nervous, so he's trying to show me that he ain't nervous. And I'm trying to show him that I'm not nervous either. So we both looking very calm. Went to the governor. Governor at the time looked very calm too, as if, oh, no problem. We have everything under control. Then the governor said, okay, we're a little up against this deadline. We must meet this deadline. This must be in the Prime Minister's hands. So go over to the House of Assembly with this annual report. In those days, no cell phones, nothing so. Secretaries, everybody gone. Me and Neville walked up to the House of Assembly like this is the only place, man. And we knock. Whitehall and Pollard, we're here to see the Prime Minister. fella had a 45 on his hip, you know. Look at you. Look, Neville up and down. He looked me up and down. He says, go forward, go in. So he said, good. We get past the first hurdle. We get to the top now. You see another fella. What are you all doing here? We are here from the central bank. We're here to see the Prime Minister. And everybody just said, go forward. We were in. Now, finally, we are right at the threshold by the House of Assembly. And we had a glimpse of the Prime Minister. It was Prime Minister Owen Arthur. Owen Arthur looked us up and down. I believe that he was wondering if he had to represent himself, you know, if he had to beat these two men. This little man and this sizable man looked us up and down. And then he says, okay, thank you very much, took the report. And that was one of my fondest memories because Neville would remain so calm. Now, we could have been probably thrown out of the House of Assembly. And maybe I wouldn't tell you what happened. But it worked out well. Everything that I found Neville was involved with, somehow it all worked out well because he's so easygoing and he was able to get all of our projects to work smoothly. Neville is loyal. I believe he is loyal to everything he does, everything he touches. I know he has been a good friend to his wife and his family. He played basketball at one time. and he was passionate about that as well. I believe he was passionate about the trade union movement and also about the central bank. I believe for him, leaving the central bank is a bittersweet occasion. Sweet because, you know, you get to go on and do some other stuff. But you're leaving an organization that you lived in, that you love. You love everyone. Neville's the type that loves everybody. He gets along well with everybody. And I know this would be a difficult day for him. He's not the type that wants to say goodbye. And he's not the type that likes a lot of attention either. But we're going to give him that attention because this is the only chance we have. He's now or never, Neville, so we're going to say whatever we want to say, but we'll say in a good spirit. Losing Neville, we're losing some institutional memory. Neville cannot really be replaced. Yes, we can find people with some of his skills, his technical skills, and social skills, but as an individual, as a person, as a gentleman that I have found him to be, he cannot be replaced. And I just want to go on record as saying that I think he is a wonderful example of what a central banker can and should be. And it has been a great pleasure knowing him. And I show that. I'm sure all of you, if you had a glass, you would raise your glasses at this time to Sir Neville and just thanking him for gracing the central bank with his presence. Thank you very much, Neville.
Thank you, Peter. Your kind words aptly describe Neville the person, and I assure you, there is a boyish and playful side to my husband. No, David, that's not for you, but what's for you is to come to the podium now and say a few words. Thank you.
Good day, everyone. Governor, colleagues, friends, man of the moment, Neville, Cheryl, invited guests. I am thankful and indeed honored to say a few words about my colleague and friend, Neville. I look at him in a professional and also a personal way. Neville reported to me when he first joined the Foreign Exchange Department and in the early days as acting supervisor. He came from the secretariat in those days, which now combines human resources, facilities management, and all those departments. He always, from the time he came, he always demonstrated a very high level of maturity and competence in assessing and identifying issues in matters which were referred to him for consideration. Over time, he developed the technical skills required for the job and was then able to manage these skills in order to solve complex applications. He became extremely confident in decision making, and I always thought his performance was consistent and matched with his skill sets. As a supervisor in the department, Neville maintained a high level of liaison with clerical staff and used his knowledge of the operation to assist and guide junior staff in the resolution of problems. Neville also motivated staff to be results oriented and generally exhibited concern for their welfare. Neville's approach to special assignments was one of fairness, and Peter has mentioned that. He applied himself diligently and researched the subject matters meticulously in order to ensure that the conclusion and recommendations were sound. Overall, From time to time, Neville joined the Exchange Control Department. His performance was always of a high quality, and everybody would be able to vote for that. It was a bittersweet moment when Neville was assigned to the Research Department. I say, here come now, he's losing a good man, and I really cannot replace him in a hurry. Anyhow, although the department would have been sad to see him go, we were indeed happy, you know, to see that he was elevated to a higher position in the bank. Now, looking at the personal side of Neville, Neville and I, we linked up around the mid-70s when he came to the department as his acting supervisor. Since that time, we have been extremely close friends. We knew of each other's family, and we have visited one another's home on a regular basis. I met his mother, I met his grandmother, and he met my mother, sister, and wife. I can recall that he was a source of inspiration to me when my mother was hospitalized after being diagnosed with cancer. He visited her with me on several occasions. I somehow, which was, you know, not good, I reciprocated the favor when his mother was hospitalized afterwards. I was extremely pleased when Neville took Cheryl as his wife. You know, it looked like, you know, like my brother. You know, they say my big brother's married now. You know, I always thought that they would make a loving couple, and so far I have not been disappointed. Neville is not all work, right? He follows the maxim very closely: all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. He can party hard. We have evidence of that. I can remember.